cool. So I'm trying to remember where I left off. Relay chess. So I recently added. Yeah, in fact, I'm gonna have to go here anyway. I added the orchestra sound set that consists of Zug's new noises. Now, for sure, these don't map one-to-one with all the other sorts of things you'll say find in just a normal chess standard deployment here. Like, in fact, let me do this without the dash L flag. So there's our standard sound set. Here's our new sounds. Obviously, there's not a one-to-one mapping. No, I completely understand. I'm not worried. Get to that whenever you get to it. I'm not in any rush regarding that. And it's great that you think that that's necessary. I just figure I'll contribute what I can. So, let's see. I need to figure out where in the index or where in the application scripts put all these events to trigger the new noises. Like, castle should be pretty obvious, defeat and victory and all that. Actually, let's start with the easy things, like victory, defeat, and draw. Let's see. For different themes, yeah, no, I hear you that that's the way it should be. That if you have a sound theme selector, that you'd only want to select the sounds as you need them. At the moment, we don't have a sound theme selector, so I'm just going to say everybody gets to use Zug's noises. And then whenever we get to making the sound theme selector, then we can change that up. And part of doing that would be that we've got to complete this orchestra theme at some point too, so that we're not relying on sounds from multiple sets, so we can use a single set. Or so if a user was able to select orchestra and get all Zug noises, would be pretty cool. I apologize if some of my code is kind of a hack. I'm just trying to solicit input from Zug without being too discouraging of him. And by Zug, of course, I mean National Master ZugAddict. He's also musician John Chernoff. So it's cool that he's contributed some of his talent for this. And I'm doing the best I can to, I don't know, make the best of what he contributed, I guess. So, let me take a look at this. Yeah, I really like some of his noises. I'm not a fan of every single one of them, but some of them I really like. So we're gonna say there's the new sounds here, which are actually WAV files rather than OGG files. Again, at some point, once we've got a complete sound set and a sound selector, then we're going to want to have everything in the right format and everything square. We still need to fix the chess.js attribute generation. I'm kind of curious what you mean by that. You're talking about like legal moves and such? Generating the... Oh, I was afraid of that. The other thing. Well, actually, no, this isn't relevant. Never mind. I was thinking about something that the Lee Chess team was doing. But it doesn't pertain to move generation exactly. It has more to do with how do you print out a move string. If you're given a move that's in algebraic notation and want to convert it to standard algebraic notation, or coordinate notation to algebraic notation, they wrote a library or utility that could handle some of that. At some point, I want to take a closer look at just the various chess.js and scala-chess.js and whatever libraries they've got, and see like which library is the one we want to build everything on top of. But okay, you're saying that only generating it for not one side doesn't work, presumably because there's some check or capture related reason that just doesn't do what it needs to do. So yeah, I can remove the logic that says only do it for one side, and we can have it generate attributes for both sides. So let's see, I added in victory, draw, defeat. What new noises have we got? Castle, I'll have to figure that out. There's new game. Yeah, new game and generic notify should actually be two separate things. So I'm gonna make new game a new thing here. New game. Grab this. Copy and paste are your friends. Okay, I'm trying to think what else. I've got draw, defeat, new game, victory. So the remaining ones are the theme, the lobby noise, and castle. So I guess I have to add all of these. So capture castle is going to be the orchestra castle.wave. There's the lobby theme, and then there's the overall theme. So I'll just put the theme down here. Since I lack a better name for it, I'm just calling it theme.wave. It's going to be the thing that plays on the home page, which realistically only gets access by people visiting the site who haven't logged in. Silence is actually just a noise that's used to stop other noises, or I don't know, it's just an empty filler noise. I guess I could get rid of it at this point. Part of the reason I stuck it there in the first place is because, one, in case we need a filler noise, and two, because this dang list, you can't stick a comma at the end of it, or else the script's gonna blow up. So I just always put this thing last, but yeah, I guess we don't need it. It's just there in case we did need a filler noise, but we probably don't. Let me get rid of it until we actually have a need for it. That was really a lot more useful when there were just two or three, and then I kept adding one and adding one, and things broke repeatedly. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot one other thing. I need to make sure my stream settings, I'm not streaming at like some ridiculous bit rate. I'm at 1800 kilobits per second. That's probably a bit much for most people. Let me try dropping that to 1200 and see if things are still a-okay. If that messes with the audio, then I'll change the audio settings again, but or I'll somehow fix it. But yeah, in an effort to make the stream more watchable, I've got to stream it at a bitrate people can download at. Also, wait, am I streaming at 30 frames a second? Yeah, I'm at 30 frames a second. Huh. Well, it's no big deal. Nobody really cares. Twitch might get confused by it, because nothing changes on most of 29 out of 30 frames. Or, yeah. But yeah, you get guys get to see some of the smoothest typing out there. So that's a complete list of noises. Oh yeah, I did make the play computer button visible in my instance. However, if people actually try to play against it, it might freeze their browsers, so use at your own discretion. Or use at your own risk, rather. So we're adding in a castling noise, changing some of the end game noises, adding a new game noise that's different from the notify noise. And I guess that's where I start, because I don't have to change the code that calls defeat, draw, or victory. Those are just automatically going to call Zug's new sounds. So what I could start by doing is changing the new game event to trigger the new game noise, now that we have such a thing. So where does that notify noise get played? I could have sworn that when the position loads, that notify does get played. Grep WR play. Okay. Let's search for something a little more specific. Let's search for dot play. Okay, that's a bit much. Why does this line of code even match? Oh, because it has a thing called play. Let's search for play with two parentheses. We don't get that other match. Okay. Not exactly what I was expecting. How's this work? Did some of that move, I wonder? Oh, now it's called play sound. Okay. We can do that. Play sound. That's right. Yeah, that's one line of code. That's so that when you download the file in your browser, it's efficient in downloading. It might be a little more tricky to read, but there's no extra characters in that file. Okay, so where was the notify noise again? I thought there was something that when the position loaded. Oh, I'm calling a thing called Chime. I suppose I don't need the thing called Chime anymore. So we're going to, yeah, that's the context under which I called it. So instead of calling Chime, we're going to say play new game noise. And inside relay audio service, we don't need to have a thing called Chime because we have a sound called new game now. All right. Yeah, that's minified code right there. That's the correct term. Okay. So, you see that put new game in place. You can see that's in the code diff now. We've already automatically got the defeat, draw, and victory noises. So I think that leaves the castling noise, the lobby theme, and the overall theme. So let's see. Is there any sound that plays in the lobby by default? I don't think so. So there's lobby controller right there. Play sound. Okay. So when we open the seek dialog, we get a click. That's cool. Let's see, where in here? Where in here can I put something that gets executed the first time you enter the lobby? I'm not sure. Anybody see a place where I can put something that executes a single time when we're in the lobby? I kind of wonder about this navigate function here. That might help. Though I'm afraid it'll play the noise twice or something silly like that. There's the open seek dialog, open friend seek dialog. As if you could challenge a friend at the moment. It's not yet implemented. So yeah. Let's just stick the code here and see what it does. And if it doesn't work in Internet Explorer or your browser of choice, that's too bad. I jest, but it's a step forward if it works at all. Okay. Refresh. Control refresh. Okay. Inspect. Oh, you guys probably can't see this pop-up window. Just see the fact that something's in blue there. Well, that didn't even show. But yeah, I've got the Chrome Developer Tools stuff here. And it's not indicating an error. So that just means, I don't know what it means. It means that the code's working just fine. That my thought of putting this here is probably a bit silly. Because I don't know what we'd call navigate anyway. Let's look for a login thing here. I mean, login's kind of wrong because what we want to do is play the sound when we enter the lobby, not when we log in. Navigate the utility function to handle changing views from the scope. If you want the sound to play, create a new function in the audio service. Ensure a lobby is playing. Oh, I forgot. Yeah. You could enter the lobby and like refresh the lobby with the refresh key multiple times. So you're right, the right way to do that would be to call ensure lobby is playing from the controller function. So that you don't get the same lobby song overlapping itself, unless that's what you really wanted. So yeah, you're right, you'd have to do it that way. Okay, we'll do it. Why not? It's the most visible, or in this case, audible noise. So might as well make it work, and might as well make it be awesome. So let's see. I want to go to the audio service and add a function. Let's see. Oh, here's a thing called a function. This is apparently how you add functions in your functions that function. Function audio service. Yeah. Well, I guess I would just have to add a thing called ensure lobby is playing and play it. Could alternatively add something that plays all the sounds just for the fun of it, but I don't know. That seems silly. 34, 27. Let's grab some lines of code. And let's see. Ensure lobby is playing equals function does not need a sound. Crude implementation is just going to be play the damn lobby sound. And then got to fix it for No, I'm just saying that JavaScript's the best language ever invented. Why isn't all code written in JavaScript? You can do anything in JavaScript. It's Turing complete. Probably. Alright. Sound. Or play sound. Lobby. If I can spell lobby. There we go. Add a comment. To do. Ensure lobby is, wait, play lobby if it is not already playing. There we go. See? I just want to get a simple unit test working first, and that's, can I get anything to play at all? So now I have to figure out where to call this from. And call that in the controller function. Okay, sure. So, which controller? I mean, we've got five controllers. I think you're talking about the navigate controller function. That's in lobby here. I could be wrong. Okay. Now does it work? Also, I should check if my speakers are on. Let's see. Oh, yep, they're on. Okay. Let's check if we got an error. Hey, no errors. That's cool. So, what am I supposed to do now? Probably put the code somewhere else. By the code, I mean the invocation of Ensure Lobby is playing. Or maybe I should log out and log back in. Maybe that'll help. Oops. Is that really the server not reachable? Or is that just it taunting me for. Oh, right. Wait. I thought at some point I'd added a guest account. Apparently not. Either way, I'm gonna need to black the screen while I put my username and password back in. So, doing that. And there we go, maybe. Or wait, maybe the server actually isn't reachable. Or maybe I'm trying to reach the wrong server or something. I don't know. I probably broke it. Okay. I see. So just put it inside here. Like there. There's relay audio defined. That's probably defined. Oh, yeah, no, it's defined by the time we get here. That's cool. That seems fine. Oh no. Is my server actually down? Wait. Been running for 11 hours. I had logged in just a minute ago. It says it's active and running. Oops, I can't sudo for that. Not from this account. So why does it appear my server's down when apparently it's up? Did I just do something dumb here? Oh, apparently I'm logged back in. Somehow. Although there are zero players online, so that also doesn't make sense. Okay, let's clear the cookies or whatever, refresh the page by force. Let's see. Well, it appears I'm gonna need to actually view the logs, so I have to do the whole sudo thing. Status cannot connect to server on first connect, but that was when? That was 7:20. That was like this morning after the power outage. Surely this came back online at some point because I've just logged in and logged out. That's really weird. I guess I'll stop it and start it back up. I don't understand what happened there. So we're gonna get back into relay chess here. Refresh again. Say we're gonna be our guest, be our guest. Oh, awesome. Oh, okay. Well, as long as there's an explanation. Let me force refresh this. I am in my instance, right? I know I did pull down changes. I must have done something pretty awesome with my last change here. Now, do I get any errors? Yeah, I got an error and that play sound is undefined. I should actually check out where is that error. Play sound is undefined in relay audio service. Oh, I have to call audio service that play sound instead of just play sound. All right. So HTML, sudo relay, JavaScript app, relay audio service. This is why we do unit tests. You don't want to build a whole ginormous infrastructure and then find out that none of it works and you have no idea what part's broken and what part actually works. All right, so we're going to try this again. Cool. It's possible the theme where the lobby could use some audio balancing. Or not audio balancing, but just, I don't know, the dynamics through the song vary quite a bit. And so I could do something to make sure they don't vary quite as much throughout the entire piece. But hey, we got music playing in the lobby. Now, what if I refresh? Okay, so refreshing does not cause the sound to overlap itself. Not sure why not. Okay, you're getting... I don't see that link. Apparently something didn't copy correctly inside that imager URL, because I'm not seeing a thing. That says that there's no image on imager for that URL. Oh, okay. Cool. So it appears that my to-do might already be a to-done, and that I have not managed to find a use case which causes the lobby to play while the lobby's already playing. So I might have over-engineered this just a little bit. But I'm sure there's some use case by which this is actually necessary. Okay, cool. So we got lobby noise. Whatever, I'll leave the method there until, or the function there until there's some need to get rid of it, I guess. So that's the lobby controller. Let's see, what other controllers do we have? We've got a login controller. I guess the login screen's not, or the login controller's not just for the login process, but also for logging in general. Okay. Oh, I see. So this skips to the login. Else, we want to just play the login for the... I want to say play sound theme. Now, of course, I have to provide relay audio as an argument here. And ensure somewhere that when controller is called, it provides relay audio. Oh, Oh, maybe the use case for ensure lobby is playing would be you don't want to like simultaneously have the lobby and multiple chessboards up. Okay, I was gonna check the other file and see whether or not that dollar sign was necessary. Because yeah, I had a hunch that that was wrong. I wasn't entirely sure, but now I know. So I have to look at where it is that. Let's just take a look at lobby controller. So there's config.js. Yeah, so this is what actually configures which controllers need what. And it magically, in this case, puts together all the dependencies that are called each time the controller is summoned from each of these respective controllers. So there's no need for me to declare here that, oh, well, now the login controller needs an additional sound provider, because those modules are already plugged into the application. So it already knows what this is. Everything's mapped, and I don't need to do anything special here. It already knows to use the relay audio service that's been constructed by the application. That's my take on it. It's probably technically a poor description, but it's functional. So we get the theme if we're not logged in. Else, if you are logged in, you just go directly to the lobby and return. Let's see. So let's log out. Force a refresh. Oh yeah, you can hear that. Maybe. Dependencies are injected by Angular. Oh. Well, that's fantastic. So I'm going to refresh this one more time to hear the theme. But really, what I'm testing is, can we get that playing? And then I log in. Okay, so this is what we were concerned about earlier, is that I could have overlapping sounds. This is fantastic. This is the work of like 10 minutes of coding. Is that we get the greatest overlapping noises ever. And this is the reason you want to have something dedicated in Relay Audio Service that says, you know, we're just going to play one song at a time. And keeps track of what's playing and cues things up as necessary or whatever. Or stops existing sounds and then starts the new ones. Let's see. I'm not so familiar with NG audio and if it provides some way of just muting sounds that are currently playing and starting up new sounds. I could look into that, or I could look into do I need to write my own audio mixer of a sort that keeps track of what sounds are playing and stops the ones that are currently playing. NG audio documentation. Here we go. I remember looking at this some time ago and getting flustered by it because I didn't know Angular either. Okay. You could actually provide a disable preload thing, directive, and say that I don't want to preload everything. You could if you wanted to. Interesting. NG audio hover directive offers a parameter called loop hover, in which you could say repeat a sound n times, or just repeat indefinitely when you hover over an element. I know that's what I'd want to do. Anytime I hover over something, just play the sound a million times. Just never stop playing it. It sounds really useful. They've really thought of a lot of things. But let's see, is there a way to just figure out what's still playing? And if so, to stop what's playing and queue something else up? Yeah, I would think that that's probably more useful than having something repeat indefinitely when I hover over a control. But what do I know? It's actually a difficult thing to do, which is why I'm being kind of silly, in being so demanding of what this library offers. So, yeah. I don't exactly see a way to stop sounds that are playing, which means I've got to keep track of it on my own. But I think really what I want to keep track of is just what song am I playing? Am I playing the homepage song, or am I playing the lobby song? And by homepage, I guess I mean the login page. So, keeping track of a single audio thing isn't too difficult. I'll just write my own wrapper for it because it's not difficult. Except when I'm coding. Because somehow when I code things, I make things difficult. Right. So, we got volume. Oh wait. There's not even. That's the thing that was confusing me, is how do I know when the song is ended? I mean, I kind of know because I've got the file on disk. What if it takes longer for some players to play it than it takes for other players to play it? Man. Nothing's ever simple. I mean, I guess I could have different sound channels or tracks or whatever for different songs. That seems a bit silly. Or maybe I just don't need a theme on the login page. Although it's an awesome theme, I think people would tire of it if they heard it in the lobby too often, but it makes a lot of sense for the login page. Really builds up the hype and suspense. For people to actually log in and see what Relay Chess is all about. So, actually, what I could do, it appears that there's a thing called progress on an NG audio object. I suppose I could, I don't know. Oh, there's actually a thing called remaining. So I could just call remaining and then call sleep for that number of seconds, assuming JavaScript has a way to sleep. Maybe it doesn't. Yeah. I play the lobby sound from the sounds array. Should be able to check for remaining. You know, I need to listen to Lobby Song again and see if this is something worth looping. I think people could enjoy this theme even if it repeats. This seems like a sort of theme that people can appreciate. I think the login theme might be a bit much, but I think this is tame enough that people wouldn't mind having it loop. So let's see, is there a loop argument to play? Or do I have to write my own loop? Oh, that's funny. Yeah, apparently I've got to write my own loop since I'm not binding the music to a control, like a button or something. Oh wait, NG audio object reference can be an NG audio object can be used to control a sound file and can be attached to the scope. I mean, I don't see where like law or load or play or any of these are able to specify parameters that specify whether or not to loop this song. You'd think there'd be a standard way to do it. You'd be wrong, but you would think so. You want to know how to loop it? While true, play. There's no way that that could cause problems. I kid. That's how you get a song that's overwhelming. It just plays the lobby sound a million times and shuts down your browser. Yeah, let me check if there's a way to sleep with a browser command. JavaScript sleep. Does it have a thing? Sleep or wait? I like how. Wait, is that an answer or is that a question? Oh, this is a horrible solution. You're going to be chewing up processor cycles while doing nothing. Okay. I'm gonna edit this answer because I found this is useful. Sleep. Return new promise. Okay. Is this an ECMA script 5 or 6 thing? I don't know. Oh, set timeout. Wait. I don't see the set timeout here anywhere. I'm confused. Oh. Okay. Dot loop equals true. Okay. So I don't want to write my own thing. Apparently. As much as I do, I don't. So sounds loop equals true. lobby that play. Yeah, that would work. And then on each iteration, increase the volume until we have unleashed the madness. Well, that's probably a bit much. Oh, I should perhaps also adjust the volume in the standard way. Although that's been, that's not been calibrated. And would need to be recalibrated anyway. So we'll do that. That's probably okay. Audio service dot volume equals 11 because we have to turn it up to 11. Again, I kid, but starts off quiet and faint. And then we got, what's that instrument? That's not a clarinet, that's a flute. Yeah, it's a flute. Clarinets are cool. But yeah, you can definitely appreciate or understand the use of a flute. Cool, and it loops, as it should. So now, what happens if I refresh the page? Okay, so it's not immune to refreshes. That's cool. And so, of course, now I need to. Oh, wait. Wait, I actually do have visibility to that object now, don't I? Oh, I'm sorry, my documentation's over here with my chat window. So I could always just call stop on the NG audio object. That way, if a person plays a game, finishes the game, and comes back to the lobby, that's fine. Now, perhaps, just maybe, I need to ensure that when we navigate to the gameplay page, I don't know, maybe they will want the sound, but they're also going to want to hear the new game sound. So I got to think about that. Because I don't think new game is loud enough to overtake the music. Or I don't think it's, I don't know, it's a lot calmer. So makes sense to stop the lobby song once we've left the page. So I guess I'm creating another function here called ensure lobby is not playing. that allows us to move on to the game page. This is going to require some more thinking at some point. So, lobby controller. We're going to grab that line of code and go into game controller. There is a game controller, right? Oh, sorry, it's called play controller. My mistake. Because you you game a play. And then once that's not playing, then I can play the new game noise as I'm actually playing down here. Somewhere. Yeah, here's the new game noise. Okay. So what else? What am I leaving out? Oh, there's the castling thing. So this one's going to be special. Oh, actually, no, this actually isn't too hard to figure out. I was thinking this is going to be some huge ordeal to determine from the move notation, is this a castling move? And now I remember, thankfully, the library we're using is fairly intelligent. So I can say we have a check for, is this a capture? We can have a check for, is this a castling move? And obviously these aren't going to be the same check. I need to take a look at okay, that's not exactly what I was looking for. I need to see where does chess.js define these bits? Oh, here we are. Flags. Capture is C. Big pawns B. Oh, hey look, we could have different noises for queenside and kingside castling. If we really wanted to. How great would that be? But yeah, the letters are K and Q. For future reference, for anybody watching this later. So, I want to change this to K or Q. I hadn't even thought that the library was going to be that useful. Alright, so proof of concept is in place, I think. Get diff. Actually, get diff overall. Oh yeah, I'm not intending to change the index page in my commit. Let's see. Always have to back out that one change in login controller. Because I'm logging in against my URL, not against some other URL. Kind of surprised. Well, whatever. So let's say get add here, get diff cached, and I'm gonna wanna back out that those lines of code that change the server URL. So I'm gonna wanna back that out also in relay chess service. Get reset head relay chess service dot js. Yeah, you're probably right. I mean, we have a thing called config.js. I'm just not sure how best to use it. I'm also kind of confused by the use of these numbers. But I mean, I guess that saves us a DNS lookup, but is that useful? I don't know. I'll save that for a future commit. Somebody's gonna, I don't know, figure that out at some point. Because I'm just not familiar with what's the best way to do it. Wait. Am I in the wrong file? JS app login controller.js, line 1. Okay. Oh, sorry. Grep moo. So, yeah, I want to look at login controller. Oh, there it is. I don't know how I missed that. But yeah, I need to paste this in again. Put this in my copy buffer. Get add login controller.js. Then put this back. Git diff. So these are all the things I don't want to commit. Git diff cached. These are the things that, I don't know, make RelayHS a little bit more interesting. Oh, right. So it's great that I did all these changes. I should probably test that they work before checking them in. Or before, at least before putting them on GitHub. I should probably, make an effort to play a game and actually verify that I can castle and get the noise and all that. So, does that work here? Let's find out. No castling noise. So sad. So very sad. Okay, we're gonna try that again. Okay. Why am I not getting a castling noise? Is there anything I could do? I should probably actually just learn how to use breakpoints from the browser so I could identify whether I've hit this condition or not. Because captures make special noises here, right? Yeah, captures definitely make special noises. So why didn't the castling noise get played? Oh, play AI uses a different controller. That explains it. So if I want to test it, want some sort of unit test. Right, I forgot about that. Two, three, four, five. Grab these 5 lines of code. Drop it in here. And refresh the page. Oh, you challenged me to beat Stockfish. I thought my challenge was just going to be to get to play the cool castling noise. But now it's on. Now it's on, because this is a worthy challenge. Except if it isn't. Hey, look, I got my rook pinned. That's great. Not pinned anymore. Okay, what the heck? Wait. This seems a lot... I forgot that we changed out the AI to be something a little intelligent. Well, crap. This is harder than the old AI. I should have known that this is actually going to be challenging. But hey, look. Oh, this is why you're saying that we need to fix the attributes thing. Oh my goodness. Yeah, and I was thinking, like, the level 1 AI was... I forgot that it wasn't the version I wrote. crap. Okay. This might be challenging, guys. Okay, I'm gonna check. Oh, if only my bishop moved like a knight when it takes here. If only. I think I'm still taking it. Yeah, that's not gonna persuade me to stay away. Oh, well, that's checked. The other thing wasn't. Wait, that says check because I made it. Okay. Great. I guess the AI works, so that's a plus. I'll just try to get the castling noise to play. Darn it. Okay. And then I got all distracted by the idea that I could just beat the level 1 AI and then remembered, oh wait, that's Stockfish. No, but did the castling thing not play? Why didn't I hear some castle noise? Oh, look, I've got this amazing output logged. But I don't see any record that a sound got played. Well, let me take a look at the logging and see, can we get... I mean, surely if we can log all these things about... first console.log. If we can log all this AI move stuff, surely I can at least log something when the audio service is playing a noise. Just so I can know, for my own sanity, that even if I never heard the castling noise, that it did in fact play. Okay. Audio. Play. And then I probably want to say what sound it's supposed to play. Play is pretty generic. Audio is pretty generic. Sound. Whatever. I just want to see something logged saying that it attempted to play the castling thing. I'm trying to intimidate Stockfish with my pre-moves. It's not working. Okay. Yeah. Says AI move, sound play move, and prior to that, oh, sound play castle. Okay, so the condition was detected. As for why I can't hear the castling noise, I don't know. Maybe it's not there, maybe I typoed on the name. I should be able to at least put this into the URL. Should get something back, I think. I think based on how I laid everything out, I think this should work. Yeah. It's a pretty quiet sound. So, I think the issue isn't anything code-wise, it's just you've got to rebalance the audio. Oh, I do hear it. Yeah, it was pretty faint, but it's there. All right, but yeah, we gotta beat Stockfish, guys. All right, here we are playing. Wait, what? Take back! Take back! No, okay. I'm screwed. Whatever. Ha! You can't intimidate me. Oh, I have to go back. Okay, I have to go forward. I have to. Ha! I take your queen. Maybe. Yeah. All right. But yeah, that does point out that it plays check instead of saying that I've lost the game. In a way, that's a little bit more reassuring because I've never lost to it until it announces my defeat. That game didn't count. It failed to declare that that was checkmate. So yeah. But yeah, I'm curious why. Why didn't it say that defeat? Oh, defeat's just not coded there. Or I typoed it. No, I didn't. Okay. Hey, look at all these differences between. Oh, never mind. It didn't do it side by side. I was gonna say, look at all these differences, but we'll just have to appreciate it this way. I guess it was previously unthinkable that you could lose to AI. But yeah, now it's possible. Oh, right, because there's no spectators and stoof. Okay. Yeah, so I forgot that it doesn't really check for a result. It just plays the checkmate, and without any drama whatsoever, it's just like, oh, you're done. You're so done, boy. You don't have any legal moves. It probably even keeps, like, attempting to allow you to generate legal moves, and you just can't because there aren't any. Yeah, no, that's cool. Yeah, if it wasn't, well, if it was not a huge ordeal, I would just code in a one-off thing here to say, we're gonna play some extra sounds, but looks like that's a bit more of an ordeal to get that to play sounds. So, again, not official. Did not officially lose to Stockfish. It's gonna be official when it actually tells me that I'm checkmated. So that said, I mean, I could play a game against myself, or if any of our loyal viewers want to play a game, I could somehow manage that. But yeah, I think the sounds work. The castling noise is in place, captures and moves still sound just fine. The lobby plays noises. The login play page plays a sound. I guess. Well, the interesting thing is that once you've logged in, you've got some sort of browser cookie that ensures you can quickly log in the next time, I guess. So, or at least that's my experience, is that once I'm logged in, that can always come back, and that's not really a problem. So the surprise from going from the login page to the lobby and hearing both sounds at once, something you're only going to experience once, or at least once per login. And I don't know, I've been coding all day and don't really feel like making everything perfect. Should probably ensure that when the lobby's playing that it stops the login noise, and when you've logged out and you aren't in the lobby anymore and you're logging back in, that it doesn't play the lobby noise anymore. Ultimately, there should be like two different sound engines or tracks or whatever so that songs can play on one. I don't know, songs are kept separate from noises, and they can be played in combination, but you can't play two songs at once, and you can't play two noises at once, I guess. Anywho, well, let me do it this way. I forget. It says zero players online. So, I must have broke something anyhow. Because I'm pretty sure I am online. But yeah, we saw that at least I got the sounds in place. Which counts for something. So, I'm just gonna commit what I've done so far. Utilize orchestra sounds, music and sounds. So I think that's good. Utilize is too fancy. Play orchestra music and sounds does accurately describe what was changed. So we're going to push that upstream. Oh, my internet connection has not dropped on me just yet. Cool. So yeah. I've got to find a way to cheat against this computer. Just like set up the board and it's missing all the pieces on its back row or something. See, can I manage that? Gotta be evil here. Play AI controller. Where's the FEN? FEN is undefined. New chess FEN. Alright, I'm gonna see. Here we are. Default position. Do, do. Not doing anything evil at all. Alright. So, var FEN is equal to this, minus a few pieces. You gotta make this a little bit easier on the humans. Oh, come on. Come on. Can I not be evil successfully? Thought I had it. Damn it. Well, as long as the engine doesn't know that it has all those pieces, I think I'll be fine. Man. Thought I was so clever. Add fen to chess ground init. Okay. Chess ground init. Chess ground. Oh, wait. Like this? That can't be it. Nope, that's me misreading something. Oh, here's chess ground. I'm sorry, it's being slow here. Bear with me. Okay, these are spaces, not tabs, and that's all well and good as long as we have one standard. Ha! There we go. Or just chess crown board. Oh, that's what you're talking about. Yeah, just these lines here. Okay, cool. So this should make the challenge a little bit easier for the human. There we go. Come on. Am I not allowed to have my moment of fun? I think this is more than permissible. All right, free pawn. It's cathartic, in a way. All right, let's take a bishop. No, we'll take a queen. Didn't see that coming, now did you? Actually, I'm kind of confused why you don't just play king here, but poor Stockfish is just, you know, kick the bucket, I guess. Yeah, couldn't handle it. Either that or somehow that move's illegal and I'm just being dumb. Uncaught type error. Cannot read property from of null. Illegal move d4 d3. Well, okay. So Stockfish is like, you know what? I made it anyway. Gonna go down with a fight. And it played d3. Gotta commend it for the fighting spirit. Alright, let me check out your video. Don't feel like... Well, I'm not going to feature it here, because... Okay, yeah, this is the thing I heard about. Yeah. Well, I don't know. It's stupid that anybody would buy it. But, man, if you can make a buck or two from it, I could see why people would sell it. You gotta know, though, that your target audience, I don't know, is gonna be providing feedback when it's discovered that on some sites it doesn't work. Yeah. So, that's me beating up on Stockfish. Man. That made it a lot easier. Although, this game doesn't count. Because, well, you know, the site never declared that I was the winner. It's only fair. Might as well have a rematch. Yeah, well, it's just a thing for relaying moves between a bot and an engine and a chess site. Yeah, and I get that. But people want it. People, for whatever reason or reasons, want such a thing. And so as long as they're gonna buy it, I'm sure people are gonna sell it. Take one of those, take this pawn, defend my bishop. Move the bishop out of the way. There we go. If you could add a proper implementation for attackers too, this would probably be enough to beat most people. Yeah, pinnacle of internet cheating. Now you don't even have to input the moves. If you want to mate it, avoid checking with relayed pieces. Oh, I see what you're saying. Still, this is really impressive. Feel bad for Stockfish now. Man, you guys make me feel guilty. Well, there's only one way to resolve the guilt. We have to undo those changes. Here we go. Check. Oh, I can't go forward. I'm just gonna do like an honorable march forward. Bravely into enemy fire. And I don't even get that honor. I think it's toying with me. Okay, there we go. Yep. Poor fish. That's okay. It got its revenge, guys. It's perfectly fine. So yeah, that's cool. Obviously, you guys could always try the AI on my site. My site's hopefully going to be up, so hopefully it remains up and there aren't any more power outages all of a sudden, like there was this morning. That'd be great. And if that's the case, yeah, feel free to play against it and, you know, feel sorry for it or don't. Also, you guys know how to, like, download that JavaScript, as every browser just downloads the scripts and runs it. So you can download the JavaScript and then, like, edit it using the whatever your browser's console is, and that use that to update the position to whatever position you choose. There's probably ways to do it. I'm a JavaScript expert, as you can tell. But yeah, you can try it on various difficulties or whatever you want to do, I guess. It's going to be there. I'm impressed, though. It plays pretty well. Also, yeah, to your comment about having a proper implementation of attackers, too. You know, the Stockfish folks have been repeatedly changing the move generator, and it's just maddening. So let's see, can we go to GitHub? Yeah, here we are. I'm going to search for official Stockfish. And, oh, come on. It's got to be here somewhere. This is forked from... Okay, apparently not. Okay, we're going to search for Stockfish. Okay. Can I not find the official Stockfish account? Do I actually have to, like, type this URL into the browser? I'll do it. GitHub. Official Stockfish / Stockfish. There we go. Let's see, they've got three pull requests. Some of these have to do with evaluation. But yeah, here, I didn't even know about this one. That's crazy. That's going to be fun for whoever takes that on. Use by piece instead of by type. And so there's more and more and more discussion that goes on about these are the proper things to consider when... I guess this is talking about move generation, and you see they've made a couple changes, and let's see, this is position.cpp, only like a zillion lines changed, so by a zillion I mean 28 lines added, 13 removed. Many of these have to do with how pieces are represented, so that's all changing. Recently, they had a whole bunch of other changes. So you could look through their change history. The things about changing how they do pruning of moves, changing like various conditions. This has more to do with evaluation and search. Rename the shift function from shift BB to shift that deals with bitboards. Changing how they detect pinned pieces, fixing bugs with stalemate and checkmate. Just a lot of these things have been completely maddening for me and having to do with my extension of this. And thankfully, I think they're done changing a lot of these, or most of the move generation related things. But yeah, for a minute there, it looked like they really wanted to tune the engine for performance. I mean, they're always tuning to some extent, but it shouldn't come at the cost of readability. And I think people are starting to calm down a bit and not worry about trying to cram, trying not to extract every last CPU cycle out of the CPU and make it as 100% efficient as possible, because if you make it perfectly efficient today, at the cost of sacrificing code readability, at the cost of just good software design in general, then tomorrow you're going to have problems trying to implement new features, and then retune it. All right, so we say we got an interesting case for the proper implementation. There's ASM fish. Stockfish ported to assembly. I don't even understand why. That's cool. I just don't get it. I mean, you've already got C++. Why would anybody even bother trying to write something in assembly? ASM fish builds. Here you'll find current and previous builds of ASM fish as of August. The BMI2 builds do not use AVX or AVX2 instruction sets, since their worth in the current implementation has been found to be dubious, as expected. Oh, you're talking about something else, not even this. This is just stages of the most recent builds. You're talking about can I find the dude? Guess I've got to go to the address bar. This looks ugly as heck, but whatever. TTHSQ QE12 ASM. Stockfish chess engine in x86-64. 1,223 commits. Update readme. Update readme. Now how old is this project? Jeez. Okay. Well, let me at least check out the README since he updated it so many times. Welcome to the project of converting. Really? You're not even talking like cross-compiling. You're talking about a one-time conversion that now I guess you're gonna have to keep up to date somehow. It's one thing to try to produce a methodology that's going to generate better executables. But another thing to claim that, oh, I'm just going to maintain this extra side project, and every time the official team changes their version, I'm going to update mine to be at least as good or better. Or something like that. Yeah, that's a huge endeavor to maintain a separate project. I like this. If you observe a crash, yeah, if you observe a crash, this whole project's done, basically. I'm just kidding, but I don't know. If you have users who are, whose applications are crashing, that's not a good sign. You don't want to deliver something that's crashing. Because who knows, when you fix the crash, you might see a huge performance drop until somebody fixes the fix and then tunes that for performance and does more fixes. I don't understand this. That's incredible. Okay, FAQ. Why not just start with the compiler output and then speed it up? Or write critical functions in ASM and include them. See, this would be my question. What's the point?
With this approach, the critical functions would still need to conform to the standards set in place by the ABI. All the critical functions in ASM Fish do not conform to these standards. Plus, ASM Fish would be dependent on a compiler, which introduces many unnecessary complications.
Yeah, why use a compiler when you can do things in assembly code? Is it the same as official Stockfish? There are inconsequential functional differences that were just too silly to put into ASM Fish. Piece lists are the prime offender. You can get 100% official and deterministic searches by setting pedantic. Okay. So, what's the performance improvement of using ASM Fish over using Stockfish? Wait. Oh my goodness. You're putting this in a README. Do you really think this belongs in a README file? Okay. That's cool. Well, at least it tells you first stable release. But usually you'd put this sort of thing in a changelog file. If you have a release, then you might, okay, fine, for lack of a better place, put the release information in the README. But it's kind of special. Yeah, special is the right word. We're sticking with that word. Okay. So, does this really work? Also, like, well, okay, if I wanted to measure the performance improvement, I guess, first of all, does the README tell me how I would build this? Because I don't happen to know how to build it. I hope that there in Linux here is a make file. Reduce size. Previous versions are in a new repo. Okay. 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 But no, how do I build this? Make file. Great. It creates things ending in .exe. Oh, apparently also creates them without the .exe. Uses FASM. I don't understand how this works. How is this platform independent or something? I don't know. Apparently you just type make and it just works. Should we try it, guys? Oh, okay. Blob master ASM fish guts linux64.asm. It's using FASM to assemble. Oh, here's make.bat versus make. So assume. Okay, so this produces Windows and Linux deliverables through Windows, I guess. And I guess this produces Windows and Linux deliverables through Linux. I don't know how it knows, like, which type to create based on parameters given to FSM, but FSM just knows that this is a Windows binary and this is a Linux binary. Okay. Great. Perfect. So I guess the appropriate thing to do, actually, the developers of Stockfish say that the benchmark tests are kind of unreliable for gauging performance anyway. That they too tend to wildly vary. So downloading this and seeing if it compiles and then running it might not be the best way to, I don't know. You'd actually have to play games against itself and see if it scores well or not. Oh, here, never mind. Speed up from bench 128, 1N. So yeah, they're noticing like a 15% speed up. It's not nothing. But yeah, the risk of this crashing, is that really worth that extra 10 to 15%? Well, I guess there's nothing near 10, but is it worth that 15% speed up? I guess somebody thinks it's worth it. But yeah, that's got to be a ton of work to maintain all this. Let's just take a look at one of their recent changes. Do not use static exchange evaluation in scoring an evasion move. Wait, this is new code? Why are they adding code when... I don't get it. The base version got rid of some code. Didn't really add much. I guess what this is... Wait, how many lines have changed overall through this single commit? 119 additions and 66 deletions. Just to give you guys an idea, this is one of the changes we were looking at earlier. Sorry for the color change there. So, the corresponding change here, 2 lines added, 8 lines removed, right? So this had to do with the move selection algorithm. Now, I guess in C and C++, there's template functions and such, and so a lot of the generated code might look quite different than what we're looking at in terms of source code. But this is a high-level language, so that's kind of to be expected, at least C++ is. So they got rid of some comment. I guess there probably aren't many comments in FASMFish. So they just trimmed off the comment just to reflect what's actually in the code. And then trimmed this out here, where when you're generating king evasion, king getting out of check moves, you don't need to evaluate the position by considering the static exchange evaluation. When you're running out of check, a human's not going to think about, oh, I'm down a knight and I'm moving out of check. Being down a knight or up a bishop or whatever really isn't so critical when you're in check. Well, it assembles. That's cool. If you have the binary, just run it and then type in the word bench and you'll get some cool statistics. Also, you could type the letter D as a command to just debug. Just type like, I could show you how Stockfish does this. Oops, let's go back a directory, Stockfish. So you can type D, you get a chessboard. You can type eval, get all kinds of evaluation information. You can type bench, and it'll benchmark the engine. So those are your, I don't know, kind of fun commands that you can run. But yeah, here, I was just saying, like, as you're running out of check, it's not really, you don't really think too much about what's the static factors in the position. Am I up or down material? You care more about, am I getting mated? Am I about to lose more material because my king's being pursued across the board? But the way this manifests itself in ASM Fish, and maybe they're just fixing bugs or doing other things, or I don't know what. Maybe this is just more generated code that has to do with, I don't know, something. I'm not really sure, but maybe they're just creating a new routine that says if I'm evading check, do it one way, and if I'm not evading check, do it a different way. And maybe that's why there's so much added code here, having to do with am I up or down material. Ooh, got some benchmarks. Cool. Yeah, I have no idea what those numbers mean, actually. But that's cool that they're there. And you could always do the same thing for the actual stockfish and see if you get some numbers. And maybe these guys who produce this code can tell you what the numbers mean, because they seem to be all over that. I'm just observing, like, what they're doing. Not, I mean, I'm curious about the effects, but not enough on a weekday and probably not on a weekend to actually look into what's the actual benefit. And I'm sure the benefit changes from day to day, week to week. Some days the C++ and C code might compile even to a more optimal binary than this. You never know. Have I thought about the implementation of detecting attack squares when checked? Yeah, that's the point you were gonna raise, that you did raise earlier. I thought about it enough to realize that it's a problem. I'm not sure I have a good solution other than I could just go back to what we were doing earlier. So let's see. Attributes, was it? Build attributes. So I had wrongly tuned this to only generate attributes for the player on move. It's kind of a problem when you're in check, either by a piece that would normally check you or by the one that wouldn't. So let's see. On the other hand, maybe there's some way of, actually, I could change this to, this needs to go one player at a time. Maybe I define build attributes that accepts a color as an argument. Instead of calling it us, just call it color. And rely on the caller to call it twice or something. That doesn't sound good either. All right. Oh yeah, I'm sure how well it does on your particular machine also depends on your machine. So if you've got a machine that has an awful compiler, maybe doing it in assembly makes sense. And probably, instead of spending all this time trying to optimize this in assembly, they should just buy a new computer. I'm not even joking. So that's pretty cool. So yeah, notes per second, 2.6 million there, is it? 2.8 million. Yeah. 2.8 million for just normal stockfish. 2.7 million for ASM fish. I mean, I guess that's within like, well, that's not even within the 1% or whatever difference that the authors were talking about, but that's pretty funny. Wait. It's slightly faster, you're saying, though. Let's see, total time taken, 2046. Total time taken. Oh. Huh. I wonder why. I do wonder why. Yeah. Apparently, from the test completed a lot faster under ASM fish, but it wasn't as verbose in its output. But that shouldn't matter. Notes searched, 5.6 million for ASM fish, 8.3 million for stockfish. So yeah, that's curious. ASM fish doesn't look at as many nodes, but it does complete a lot faster. Which, I mean, that's not an apples to apples comparison, so pick your poison, I guess. Poisoned apples sound nice. So let's see. How do I? Oh, I just need to create a loop here that iterates through both colors. So I don't remember what's the appropriate way. I think it's for X and Y to do this. So say for color in blah blah blah, and do this for color in turn not turn. Is there any way to negate the color or get the opposing color? Actually, I know what the two colors are. They're just white and black. And for that, I need to execute all the following code. Yeah. I was thinking of making a build attributes for color thing. I'm not yet seeing the utility in it. I'm being a little bit slow here, but whatever. So what happens when I code when I'm tired? Okie dokie. It's gonna be fine. Everything's gonna be fine. That's what I get for trying to over-optimize things and I don't properly create a test. Next time I should make some sort of test before making a code change. Okay, and then we'll say us is now going to be just color. Oh, that was only referenced once. There we go. Fixed. Maybe. Yeah, I'm not a Vim expert, unfortunately. See, that's line 922 from line 892, so that's 31 lines. Wait, why is that not? Oh, because I can't spell things correctly. So we're going to take a look at HTML relay s.js. And if I can like not make a million typos, plunk that in there. And that way if I made a coding error, now I've made it in both places. That's just fantastic. And we're gonna log out there, stop the service, and start the service, and hopefully have not completely broken everything. But you never know. Okay, so let's go back. Hey, got this page. So I got, that looks fine. Play the computer, sure. Just bring the king forward, make sure everything works just right. Hey, I'm not even in check. Let's see. I can't even, how far can I advance my king? Here we go. Ah, yeah, that is check. I take your pawn. I force to go back. Alright, I go up here. Yep. Well, it looks like it all works. So, that's our test. I'm just kidding. I guess we gotta play a proper game. Alright, so e4, f4, g4. Oh! Maybe I just won. Maybe I'm a winner. Okay, let's figure out how did I win. Illegal move, b8, c6. Yep. Turns out you can't play b8, c6, computer. I know you wanted to, but I'm just forbidding it. Yep, that move is forbidden. It's a verboten. Not sure why, but hey, it works to my favor, so by default, I am the winner. Yeah, I don't know why I can't play knight c6. I guess we'll try to repeat this. e4, f4, g4. It's like the Konami code. Just up, up, down, down, left, right, left, right, BA start, something. Yeah. I have apparently confused it. So, yeah, I have no way of knowing. Well, I assume that, I mean, that's gotta be legal. So whatever I've coded, utilizing this chess.js still isn't working. So my attempt to fix the previous broken thing has just broken something else. It's lovely. So let's take a look at build attributes and just see, like, can I break things further? Pieces equals material. For color, we look through each piece. Var I is equal to pieces n. Board attributes undefined. We have a piece. Get piece attackers. Huh. Yep, yeah, I'm not seeing how I broke it. I mean, this is only for generating attributes anyway. Black was just trying to move a knight the same way that a knight normally moves. I'm not sure how in the world I could have broken that. It's got me confused. So each turn calls build attributes. obviously I just need to print out more debug info. Things like, what did it even get my G4 move? Or was G4 just so ridiculous, so sublime, that the JavaScript couldn't even conceive of such a move? G2 space G4 did get logged. Search AI move. It's looking at things like queen D6. Then ultimately settles on knight C6. Well, I could try tweaking the min depth parameter. That's probably not the problem. AI move. Illegal move B8 C6. Yeah, I don't know if this is just a fault of my latest chess.js change. Okay, we can actually look at my pre-moves. It's wonderful that I can pre-move this pawn to B3. Even though there's no black piece even capable of moving to B3, I can say, yep, that's my pre-move. That's my pre-move. That's my pre-move. Not all these pre-moves are equally likely to occur as real moves. Also, it's great. I can move the knight like a queen. Just like knight takes A7. Pre-moving it just because you never know. Right, yeah, I'm just saying, it's really no big deal. I'm just observing that it's just fun. I can move my king like a knight. Yeah. I can even move my king into check two different ways. Wait. Oh, yeah, you're right. No, I could, in theory, play king takes king. That's pretty awesome. Wait. I wonder, from the start position, do I have that as an option? Okay, that'd have to be a pre-move, so... Wait. Yeah. Now, if you watch here, I could pre-move king takes king if I could just get it quickly enough. There we go. Oh, and it rejects my pre-move. It actually validates the move. Bummer. I almost got to pull a fast one on Stockfish. Alright, Stockfish. Wait, can I not check you? Can I not, like, move any of my pieces? Because that might be the problem. Of course I can move them on my opponent's turn. See, this is what I get for having too much fun, just like saying, I'm going to move all my pawns. And turns out that I've broken all the piece moves. That's the kind of valuable information you want to know. Okay, so how did I even break this? White and black are... Oh. Hang on. It's probably because I don't know how to do for loops in JavaScript. That's probably it. Okay. I could have sworn that... Whatever. Var color. Oh, really? So the code executes, but, okay, whatever. Let me refresh. Still don't have anything. For var color in white black. How did I do material, anyhow? R, can I type tonight? Okay, so I didn't actually have to iterate through types. Okay. Grep white. So white and black are B and W here. They're not somewhere that we do X in Y. Yeah, we do. Okay. But yeah, down here, where I say color, this is actually going to have to be, I don't know what. Yeah, we're gonna have to test out the debugger, and by that I mean it's gonna make fun of my coding choices. But let's see, inspect console sources something. Well, now we're gonna have to do a window capture, or not a window capture, a screen capture. Here we go. Oops. So look at me coding, being really awesome. Okay, so somewhere here I go find a way to put a breakpoint on a line of code. Not that code, not that code. Let's find white, comma, black. And put a breakpoint here. Oops. And then push a pawn. Okay, so our value of color is at. Right, because you know, at is one of the values of white or black. There's W, there's B, and yeah. Why shouldn't color just be at? Or that's a zero, isn't it? Not an at. Yeah, so, but this is an array. But you're saying just, I don't know how to do things in JavaScript. That's the point. I'm sure eventually I'll learn this stuff. I was actually gonna go check this in a tutorial or something. But then we thought it'd be more fun to do this in the debugger. So let's see. Can't type in the search bar unless. Oh, wait, am I stuck with my? No, I'm not. For each. They tell you not to use for each. They say use for instead. I mean, there's the normal for. Oh, that's not the thing I was even looking for. This is the thing I was looking for. A for of loop. Array for each. A simple for loop. Or for in with safeguards. For of. Is for of what I'm looking for? I've read through this numerous times, and I'm just not retaining any of it. Use for incorrectly. Yeah, this, you have to say object get attribute. Use an implicit iterator. Oh, it's of, not in. That's the difference. So, and it's not saying that all browsers, not all browsers do equally well or equally poorly optimizing that. So for key in A, Okay, apparently you still have to declare it as var something. Not sure why. Why do I have to declare everything? Apparently you just do. Okay. So, oh, have to go back here. Dismiss that. Back to my page. Refresh. Okay. I still don't have anything. So we want to go back and inspect the page and see, not the page, we want to inspect the application or wherever it was that we had chess.js. No, I changed this to for of, not for in. It should, at some point that change should propagate. If I just like forcibly refresh the page enough, hopefully eventually it's going to pull down the right version. Continue. Yeah, I'm confused why. Oh, here's a thought. I can just say delete this from my local cache such that it gets refetched. Or I can say refresh or something. Wait, I can persist it, but I can't delete it. How does that make any sense? And no matter how many times I do Control F5 on the page, it's not going to refresh this particular file. So I want to say relay.js chess.js. I can do that. Copy relay.js chess.js. It's still pulling down the old version. Did I just like not save this or something? Am I just being really dumb here? No, I've definitely saved the file. Oh, it's in the wrong directory. HTML. There's two copies of this. One that's used by the server, one that's used by the client. So if I want the client to pull down the new version, I've got to provide that new version to said client. Okay. So it's for of. And there we are. Our pieces can move again. So we can push all of our pawns with impunity until the instant where things do go awry. Wait, I wanted to push that pawn two squares, not one the first time. Oh no! Oh, wait, I'm not mated. Haha. Eat that, stockfish. I didn't get mated that time. You can't trick me that easily. Although, why didn't you just... Well, why do I even bother? Why did you not just take the rook? Is that too much? I just don't get it. It's being nice, I suppose. Like, why snatch the... Oh, wait, is it seeing some kind of mate? I hope not. It's not possible. To quote every villain ever. So... Okay, we'll just develop the rook. Oh, because I'm hanging both rooks. That's great. But, okay, you could have taken that this or last turn. You could have taken this or last turn. Why are you teasing me, Stockfish?
Why are you giving me a false sense of hope? Do you not realize how mean that is? Okay, I attack your queen. Okay. I can't block with this knight. Well, I can't even block with that knight because it's pinned. Okay. Well, I guess I have to move the king. This is going fine. Everything's A-okay. Maybe I'll trick it into promoting, and the promotion might not work. Check. Oh, that promotion worked. I don't know why it took a knight, check, but it's being silly. Up, 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 up. Oh, that's the game. Bummer. All right. But yeah, I guess I fixed the JavaScript. Even though I'm not sure what the test case was that I broke in the first place, it works now. So, get status, get add chess.js, HTML, relay, chess, get diff. Consists of all the things we don't want to save. Okay, commit, build attributes for pieces of both players. If I can spell players. Push our game master. Okay, I unborked it. It's unbroken. So, yeah. Not exactly sure what was broken to begin with, don't know the use case, but now it's iterating through each color. Still using the more efficient algorithm that doesn't loop through every square and then loop through every square again, but loops through the squares once, builds up a table of all the pieces for one color, generates attributes for one color, gets the pieces for the other color, generates attributes for that color. And does so pretty efficiently there, so that's a good thing. But yeah. Oh, also I should probably restart the server using the fixed server code. You know, that might not be a bad idea, just so actual games can take place. So what was broken is if the opponent moved a piece out of the reach of a piece, the attribute would stick. If the opponent moved a piece out of the reach of a piece, the attribute would stick. Oh. So, okay, that makes sense. I didn't know that attributes moved as pieces moved, but now that you mention it, that does make sense, because pieces is a separate collection. So if you like moved a king that's next to your queen all the way across the board, the king would still be able to move like a queen. So yeah, it's too permissive. Could probably break a few other things that way too. But yeah, attributes would stick after a player's made a move. And they would fail to be recomputed after a player's played a move, so discoveries would be special too. But okay, it's fixed. That's cool. You know what else is cool? That's cool. You know what else is cool? Help! 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 Yeah. And then there's Kausei. Oh. Then there's Fortune, pipe to Kausei. You will have domestic happiness and faithful friends. Troubled day for virgins over 16 who are beautiful and wealthy and live in eucalyptus trees. Don't look now, but the man in the moon is laughing at you. And then we go back to relay chess. Go back to our lobby. The man in the moon is laughing at you. Unleash the madness. What is Kausei? I wonder, can I pipe man cow say to cow say? Yeah. So here's what cow say is. Can I do this cow say with 240? Oh. Man cow say. Oh, it's capital W for width. All right. Configurable speaking or thinking cow, and a bit more. Generates an ASCII picture of a cow saying something provided by a user. If run without arguments, accepts standard in. Word wraps the message to about 40 columns and then prints the cow saying the message on standard output. To aid the use of arbitrary messages with arbitrary whitespace, use the -n option. If it's specified, the given message will not be word wrapped. It's possibly useful if you want to have the cow think or speak in figlet. Don't know what figlet is, but yeah, you get all these options, and you can use the -e to specify the appearance of the cow's eyes. In which case, the first two characters of the argument string will be used as the okay, that's cool. The F file allows you to select a cow picture. And there's a cow file format. There's compatibility with older versions of CowSay. You can define environment variables and files and report bugs, if there are any. That's cool. But yeah, it just allows you to print out messages and use cows. Okay. Well, let's take a look at Figlet. What do you got to say about Figlet? Okay, that's a lot of text. We're gonna do it this way, actually. Display large characters made up of ordinary screen characters. Fig characters. Okay, that looks frightening. Yeah, I guess you're doing something special there. I'm not sure what. But yeah. Definitely piping fortunes into cows. It should be a standard feature of all modern operating systems, honestly. I don't know how you could have an operating system and not have fortune cookies being read by cows. You plan things you do not even attempt because of your extreme caution. Yep, that's totally it. Let me disable the... There we go. But yeah. I think we got sound playing in the little lobby here. I'm not sure I can hear it anymore. Maybe I did something dumb to break it. I don't know. That sound works. I was pretty sure earlier that I did get some sort of lobby sound working. It was beautiful. If not, I could always fix it later. So yeah, that's Relay Chess. We've got castling noises, which none of us have heard yet. We've got the... actually, we did hear it. It was just quite faint. Yeah, I'll have to work on generating some more sounds, filling in some of the gaps, and maybe converting sound formats and doing some audio balancing stuff. You know, just so we have some beautiful sounds. Login in the lobby's probably broken. Bummer. Well, I can always fix it. It would be a shame to have such a great server, such a great service, and then not be able to log in. Shoot, there was one other thing I was going to do. Oh, so yeah, the LeechS team developed a way to convert coordinate notation into standard algebraic notation. I was considering doing some code golfing with it, in particular with one more feature that they want, which is to, well, they don't necessarily want this, but I do, which is to generate proper standard algebraic notation. So say if you've got a position where you've got a knight on f3 and a knight, that's a bad example. So you got a position where you have, I'm not even sure how you'd set this up. Basically, you've got two knights that can go to the same square. Oh, you got a knight on c3, you got a knight on g1, and you got a pin here. And you play the move knight e2. You would write this down as a human as knight e2, not knight g e2. And I was going to do some code golfing to see if I could make something that works well, that performs okay. It's not a huge download. By that I mean does not add many lines of code to figure out how to disambiguate a move properly. Currently, their implementation just prints out knight GE2 all the time, even though there's only one knight that can go to E2. So I was going to do some code golfing trying to make that work and make it awesome, but not feeling that at the moment. So yeah, that's the coding we're doing today. So if that's all you tuned in for, I guess thanks for watching. If not, then we're going to move on to one other thing. There's a new chess site out there. I just found out about this the other day. I don't remember the name of the person who developed the site. I'm sorry, I'm drawing a blank on that. But yeah, look forward to this at a future time. This is Hello Chess. And I'm going to show it off sometime in the future. Not right now. But yeah, look forward to that forthcoming at some point. Yep, so yeah, thanks for watching, and I'll see you around sometime.